So let's hear the third excerpt now, which is going to be the last part of the prelude. And I would say, without any question at all, that this section of the prelude is the section, the single section in Parsifal that most impressed the French, both in terms of the sound color and also the atmosphere. There's an extraordinary kaleidoscope of mixed colors here, constantly shifting colors. You can never even almost identify one because he's taking instruments in and out. They play part of the tune and then they're out of the tune. It's absolutely miraculous to follow the score in this part, to see how, you know, the tune will be mostly carried the first time by the English horn and the bassoon, but then with an intervention of two oboes and the horn, they're coming out at different places. And the second time it's carried mostly by the horns, now with the cello, and then with the intervention of the oboe, and then the last time with oboes and clarinets, with intervention first of the trumpet, and then intervention of the oboes, and intervention of the trumpet again. All these things going on, very, very complicated. Now, you're not supposed to know, I mean, that's not, but the effect is this amazing sort of kaleidoscope of sounds, of constantly very heavily colored sounds. Now, what does this remind you? What artistic form is this like? What is an artistic form where you can't even really identify exactly what colors you're seeing, and yet it seems incredibly colored? Impressionism, thank you. This is enormously, almost unexaggeratably influential on French art in the late 19th century, and Impressionism especially. But the whole, not just Impressionism technically, because Impressionism technically had already begun when Parsifal was written, but Impressionism sort of more aesthetically, and more almost the concept of it, the concept of this all-embracing, constant coloring, highly sensual, completely unidentifiable light, in this case, sound. Don't forget, this is the period, and this was inspired to a large extent by The Ring, really, but the work they loved was Parsifal, was the first Wagner society in the world was where? Paris, and founded by Mallarmé, who never heard a note of Wagner, as far as we know, but the great symbolist French poet, because the symbolists, what they embraced in Wagner was this idea of the union of the arts, that music was in a way the champion of the arts because it was the least coherent, this is of course the Schopenhauer, the least real, as it were, but that painting, poetry, imagery, literature, and music should all work together, all gain from each other to create this all-embracing work of art, which Wagner called the Gesamtkunstwerk, which in a funny kind of way, Wagner himself had to some extent already, let's say, outlived or it evolved greatly by the time he writes Parsifal. This was his idea when he was first planning The Ring. But nevertheless, this is a very Wagnerian idea, which the French take up very much in their own way, and which, God knows, Impressionism is very, very, very much part of, this concept. So this kind of sound, Impressionism of the artwork, you can't hear where one thing starts and one thing ends, where everything blends and everything else. And this is very, very much part of the secret of the sound of Parsifal, which is linked to the secret of the sound of Bayreuth, the acoustic at Bayreuth. Who can say which comes first? You know, there's no, this, the chicken or the egg, or, you know, this mother of invention and all that kind of thing. Let's go to a different kind of passage now. Let's go to the next. You should have eight altogether, is that right? Okay, good. This is five. This is from Parsifal also. First act. This is... No, wait a second. Is this? Didn't I change that? Play it for. I better hear what it is. Okay, actually that's from Act 3, as it happens, it doesn't matter. If you want a name, that's usually what's called the miracle, the Vona motif, but I don't know why, but well, because it's sort of a miracle attached to it. Very strange sounds and strange modulations. Let's hear now from Die Walküre, a motif which is extremely similar, but quite different sounding. Do I need to play the first one again so you can hear make a comparison? Yes, let's do it. Play, would you go back and play 1, 2, 3? Yeah, number 4. Disregard this. Sounds are very mixed. That's enough. Thank you. Now play again the next one.
Oh.
little flute on top. The sound of the flute. Just a flute. Now, an oboe. Solo oboe. And now muted strings with harp. One is a better way than another, although I think this is far, in this particular case, far greater music, but it's just different ways. Am I being clear? They're just completely different kinds of ways of dealing with sound. One is where everything is sort of clouds and folds into the other one and mixes into the other one, and you can't tell, and these are these beautiful primary colors. Okay, so that sort of defines the difference. I have two more things I was going to play. Let's see where this one is. Could you play the next excerpt? Because I didn't write down what it is, so I won't know until I hear it either. I know what it is. So what do we think about this? What kind of sound is this? Now this, I mean, sounds really beautiful, but this is a very interesting case. It's also an interesting case of just what a great composer Wagner is, because this is a throwback to ring sound, or the sound of Wagner's earlier. There we have a long oboe solo, and then the clarinet comes in, and then there's muted strings, and there's not muted strings, and there's very, very, very clear lines, very clear sounds, very clear, distinction between accompaniment and melody. Now, there's a couple things, though, I'd also like to point out. What happened as soon as the singer started singing? Don't forget, this is Bayreuth. What happened to those solo lines and the winds? You couldn't hear them anymore. They're gone. It doesn't work at Bayreuth. It just doesn't work. Good Friday Spell never sounds as good at Bayreuth as it does in other theaters. When the orchestra's by itself, it sounds fine. But once the singer starts singing, you can't hear the orchestra anymore. Wagner was a great pro. He wrote for the theater he had. But, you know, he had, maybe the sound image he had in mind for the Good Friday Spell was a certain one, but it just creates a problem. I mean, a potential problem. It still sounds beautiful, of course. And is this Jess Thomas? I think it probably is, early Jess Thomas. Anyway, it sounds good. This is, by the way, Knoppertsbusch, 1962, Bayreuth. By the way, it's not slow. If you notice, I mean, not especially slow. Does anybody? What? Oh, you think so? Yeah. Well, that's good. I agree. I mean, it sounds like Parsifal. And there's no question. You know, I have mixed feelings about Bayreuth, although I miss it terribly. I haven't been since 2007, sort of semi-boycotting it right now. But you got to hear Parsifal at Bayreuth. It was written for the theater. It sounds there like no place. There, that's something everybody has to hear, Parsifal at Bayreuth. I'm not a huge lover of Parsifal. I mean, I love it, but not like I do other works. But that's an experience you have to have, because it really sounds. But anyway, the Good Friday, but for our ears, it's extremely refreshing to hear these solo lines. After all this extremely complex blended sound, to have these solo lines in the Good Friday spell, I think. And Wagner wants the Good Friday spell to be something, it's like a visitation from another world in a way. It is a visitation from another world, as this redeemed nature, as it says. Although, as he points out, it's not nature that's redeemed, it's man that's redeemed so he can see nature in all of its beauty. Yeah?
So you talk about the binary color.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. That would be a good point, but in Wagner anyway, but not in the French. I mean, this gets us into major aesthetics, because of course French Impressionism, the major motivation behind French Impressionism was to represent the way it feels to be in nature. But what they also determined was that the way it feels to be in nature is not the way it scientifically looks to be in nature. That nature does not feel like a photograph. Because we see things in movement, we see things with the light changing, we see things as part of a state of mind. And so the best way, as far as the Impressionists, but not just the Impressionists, all the late 19th century, early 20th century movements, Expressionists also, post-Impressionists, Pointillists, all these various movements, as far as they feel, the best way to express reality is not by primary colors, as it were, by depictions sort of photographically exactly of nature, but rather of trying to conjure up the way it feels. Now, I think Wagner does it both ways, actually, in the primary colors, too. I certainly think that the forced murmurs, the music in Siegfried, which consists entirely of solo lines, all the birds are played by solo, and nevertheless captures up fantastically the sense of being in nature, being in the woods. So it's not, it's an aesthetic rather than a practical difference, I think, largely. Yeah, could be. Actually, that's a good question, good answer. Because another time in Parsifal we do hear solo lines is that place in Act One, which forecasts this, which I played yesterday, that. And all the answers, those are all solo lines, too. It's a solo oboe and a solo horn and a solo bass clarinet, solo viola. So, yeah, maybe Wagner is using a primary colors for natural. That's possible. Nature does play a role in Parsifal, not as big a role, perhaps, as it plays in The Ring, but it plays a role in Parsifal. Yeah? Well, I can think of a lot of reasons, but the number one reason is because, by and large, conductors hate it. There's practically never been a conductor who conducted at Bayreuth who didn't try to get them to take it off, or at least change it. Richard Strauss, for starters, but Schulte also, and Akarian. It's frustrating. I mean, like everything else, it's a mixed blessing. The pros of the covered pit are... What are the pros of the covered pit? Let's hear from you, and then let's see. Well, yes, okay, that's Cecilia, that's a very good answer. There is the aesthetic experience of being in the theater. If the theater is supposed to be an all-embracing experience for the audience, having a 60 or 80 or 100-piece orchestra and a conductor, all with their lights and stands and reading books, in some cases, or coming and going, or things like that, is a big distraction. They're not part of the story, as it were. And so having them in front of us, especially if you're like in the balconies or boxes, is very definitely, or can very definitely be a visual distraction. Excuse me. But any other reason? Right. The singers can be heard without having to scream. Yeah, I think that that's That would be sort of the traditional truth. I have to say that I've heard performances in traditional opera houses of all sizes and shapes, Washington or La Scala or Vienna Staatsoper, even the Met, which is really ridiculously huge, where I've heard the singers just fine. Just fine. Absolutely fine. So I don't think, and Wagner actually, I know, he writes it, is the purpose is not so that the singers will be heard, although part of it will be so the singers won't have to scream. That's true. Singers won't have to force to be heard. But there's something else Wagner writes about. Anybody else know why? Yeah? That's an interesting answer. Sounds more spiritual. Maybe it does. Maybe it does. That I can't speak to, but it's a more blended sound. Sounds more like the organ. It does sound more like the organ. Because organs, all the sounds on the organ are blended. That's absolutely true. But going back to Wagner's intent, what does Wagner say why he wants to have the... He talks about, as Cecilia pointed out, the visual distraction, but he talks about something else. Wagner says that there's two essays of Wagner that everybody should read, because they're actually not even that horrible. And in terms of the density of their language and what they talk about is interesting, and neither anti-Semitic or racist or anything else. And they're both from 1870. One is on conducting, and the other is on Beethoven. And he talks about the fact that any good professional conductor can balance singers with the orchestra. It's just a question of being good and professional. But, he adds, it is indubitable, and he wrote this before the pit at Bayreuth existed. He just was imagining it. There's a big difference between trombones playing piano and playing fortissimo in intensity. So his idea of having the cover is that the brass can play, the instruments can play intensely with all the intensity of forte, of fortissimo, but yet soft enough not to cover the singers. That's a big difference in saying that they cover the singers. It is true that at Bayreuth, the orchestra never covers the singers. But with some conductors, the orchestra also never covers the singers. And in some places, it's not necessarily clear the orchestra shouldn't cover the singers. You know, the climax of the love duet in Tristan or something like that. Maybe I'm not so sure that the orchestra should not cover the singers. I mean, I'm a piano soloist. That's what I do for a living. And we all grew up in a generation of artificial recordings where the volume of the piano and the violin soloist is just, you know, jacked up enormously. And you have this enormous piano solo and the orchestra sounds the other room. And then people go to concerts and they say, God, the soloist, he has no sound, because they're used to this artificial sound of recordings. So pianists bang and they force and they have them jack up the sound of the piano and jack up the sound of the piano to try to make the listeners, and they ruin the whole sound. But that's not what composers. The composers knew what they're doing. They knew what it sounded like. There are places where the solo should be drowned out by the orchestra. But in the case of Wagner, most of the time, he wants you to hear the words. Now, the climax of the Liebestod and the climax of the Tristan love duet, they're not saying much of anything anyway. So there's not, you know, it should all just be engulfed in this passion. But I think that hearing the words is very important in Wagner. And conductor being able to balance is really important. But I don't think that the decal, the cover, is the only solution to that. And the reason it's not been done is because I think that most theaters felt, also they feel that it's not, it would only work for some operas. It's not clear to me that it works for Tristan. It certainly doesn't work very well for the early, like Lohengrin and things. What about Verdi? That's true, the orchestra makes a tremendous racket in Verdi, but they're always doubling the singers. So it's just a question of making them play softer because they're playing the same music the singers are singing. This is a big problem in Wagner. The orchestra and the singers are not playing the same music. So if you have the orchestra go down too long, you're not hearing stuff, so, you know. Whereas in, yeah?
The elements that are about the difficult things of conducting, is that number one, it's difficult because the instrumentalists can't hear each other. They can't hear their own instruments because they're so noisy.
I bet it's incredibly noisy down there.
Second thing he said, that I thought, is
behind, yeah, because it takes that long for the sound to get to them. That's right. One of the reasons they have to rehearse so long at Bayreuth is they have to get used to that, especially new singers, and also, let's think about something else. We say, oh, the singers, how great it is for the singers because they know they can't be drowned out. And that's true. I think the biggest single plus of Bayreuth is the effect it has on singers. Not that you can hear them, but that they don't scream. singers that I've heard at other houses, like Peter Hoffman, for instance, when shows how old I am, or well, I can think of a lot, who just sounded awful, sounded fine at Bayreuth because they didn't force it at Bayreuth, because they knew they could be heard. But to them, when they first start rehearsing, the orchestra sounds unbelievably loud. I mean, incomparably louder than in any other house, because it's coming right at them. In a normal opera house, the sound's going out that way. I'm behind the sound, you know. Would be as if you have the speakers going there, I'm standing here. It's not very loud for me. But all of a sudden, they're right in front of the speakers, because the sound of the orchestra coming right at the stage. They have to get used to that. It's an act of faith. And there's the timing. It's very hard to conduct at Bayreuth. Agioi, sure, he could not get the timing right. Right, he was new. And that's probably, and Schulte didn't conduct a lot at Bayreuth, and then he withdrew after 2 years. I don't think he'd ever conducted there before. Yeah, but Richard Strauss, even though he did conduct some at Bayreuth, always complained too about it. I mean, it's just a different experience. I mean, I think, obviously Thielemann loves conducting at Bayreuth, and has conducted a great deal at Bayreuth, and is very successful at Bayreuth. But I have to say, Thielemann doesn't drown out the singers other places either. And conductors drown out singers either because they're not good or because they don't care. And they're not always the same thing. There are certainly performances where I would wish the conductors would totally drown out the singers. Yeah, many actually, I'm sorry to say. Okay, let's go on now to our last example.
Thank you.
This, of course, is from the Transformation Music in Act 3. So this is right after the Good Friday spell, and they're heading back to Montsalvat and Titurel's funeral and the final scene. This strikes me as a perfect example of just how good Wagner has become at this very heavily mixed. Again, the melody line is played by a gazillion people all the time, but always changing. And it's like an organ. I was thinking very, very much like an organ, but as if an organ could change its stops constantly, which of course it can't. Like it changes stops right in the middle of a line. You know, it's this constantly fluctuating sound, which you hear very, very clearly in this passage. And then of course with the bells coming up, this is one of the really most, I think, powerful passages in all of Parsifal, really in all of music. Let me go back now to conclude a little bit to the fascination of Parsifal to the French in particular. I think on top of the fascination with this very highly colored sound and highly mixed, blended sort of sound, there is another aspect too. Unfortunately, I couldn't find the quote. I think it's Zola, but it might be actually, who wrote Au Rebours? What happened to my head? Excuse me? Au Rebours in French, against the grain. In English, it's called. Thank you. Richemont, thank you. Richemont. It's Richemont who said it. Richemont said that the ultimate French fantasy was having sex on the altar of a cathedral. I didn't say it, he said it, right? That what I think is so uniquely attractive, seductive about the world of Parsifal to the French is that it combines this flavor, this aroma of incense. You can almost, there are parts of Parsifal where you can sort of smell the incense, the ritualism, the sense of the church, Montsalvat itself, the feeling. And yet, in this highly sensual, highly, in some cases, sexual atmosphere, I think they find that an extremely seductive combination. It doesn't necessarily have to be a Richemont, because of who he is, you know, the decadent, is doing so in sort of like Beardsley or you know, Oscar Wilde would have done, a kind of, you know, sort of immersing yourself in filth and enjoying it kind of thing. Rather, it could be, there was a much more innocence, I think, I think of the composer Gabriel Fauré, certainly terribly influenced by Parsifal. His music has certainly sort of an innocence, if you can, such a thing exists, sensuality, very, very sensual. But there's always the sense of the bells of the church. There's always this feeling of bells, of the, maybe because the French, the actual locus foci of their existence is the village, and the village is dominated by the cathedral, and the cathedral has its bells. The sense of the sound of church bells as being kind of the real heart of human life and human existence and social life and existence and social drama. And so the drama, and in Proust also, certainly, the town of Combay, he starts by depicting Combay, and the first thing he depicts in Combay is the cathedral in Combay. And Proust is anything but a writer particularly interested in theology or the church in itself. But this background of the French culture, I think he feels also, it's very, very central. And combining that with this highly sensual, highly, sometimes perhaps decadent, it's not, I think that Parsifal was particularly attractive to the decadent movements also. Even though Parsifal at the end has some kind of resolution, there was something which they viewed as being decadent about the story. Sure, I mean, the flower maidens, the imagery of it, even though, of course, the flower maidens are unsuccessful. And Kundry's attempt to seduce Parsifal by telling him that she's his mother is unsuccessful. Still, nevertheless, I think they found that there was some kind of wonderfully seductive, incense-tinged aroma, perfume of decadent sexuality. So I think that that's another reason for Parsifal's extraordinary success in France at the turn of the century. Okay, anybody have any questions? Nobody has any questions, yes. Mm-hmm.
how the music in the ring carries the drama, and how in Parsifal it doesn't play that role. Can you, you know, give us a general sense for listeners new to Parsifal?
Uh-huh.
What should we be listening for the music to do?
In the ring, the music is the drama. It's more than to say the music carries the drama. The music is the drama. They are completely, entirely inseparable. You cannot, you can't separate them at all. It's not, in Parsifal, the drama is sometimes like, almost like a theater of marionettes, theater of symbolism, the theater of ideas. And the ring puts, I mean, the music, the orchestra, puts flesh on those symbols. So in a certain kind of way, the function of the music in Parsifal is even greater than it is in the ring. As Simon pointed out, you can read the story of the ring and get something out of it. You really can't read the story of Parsifal and get anything out of it at all. So if any sense, any to be gained from the experience of Parsifal has to be gotten through the music. But where it's not like the ring is, you can't make such clear, easy correspondences. You can't so clearly talk, as I was talking about today, that Kundry, Amfortas, and even Klingsor have more or less the same music. It's just basically music of suffering, longing, suffering, sexuality, whatever. So it's not as clear in a way. But I think the way to understand Parsifal lies certainly absolutely through the music. Would you disagree with that? Okay, good. Otherwise, you'd have to come to fisticuffs, and it's not good. Yes.
Earlier, we were talking about primary colors in the music. I think as we were talking about the Good Friday spell, and I was thinking that. It's sort of a sparkling quality with the triplets and the solos that it's not just primary colors, but it's the fact of colorfulness, variety of colors, like pointillistic colors, instead of the mixed timbres that you have in the prelude where there's more of an impression of a bright white spiritual light. That this is a, so you have a contrast between the nature and the heavenly, and it reminds me of the Siegfried, the Forest Murmurs.
Mm-hmm. Well, it certainly reminds me of Siegfried and the Forest Murmurs, and I showed yesterday how the music is very similar, motifically very similar. I agree with everything you're saying, except I would be very wary about this association with this mixed color sound with the angelic, because there's no better passage as mixed color sound than one we just heard, the transformation scene in Act 3. And there ain't nothing angelic about that. That's about as suffering as it gets. So I'm not. Yeah. Right. And I want to be clear. When I said about pure colors, it's not. Obviously, this is also very complicated orchestration. And there's all this wonder in the Force Murmurs, let's say. All that stuff going on with the strings and on top of it, you know, showing the murmuring of the forest. I'm talking about the melodic colors are played by solo instruments. And they have their pure essential kind of color. Whereas in Parsifal, there's the same kind of complex background, perhaps. Well, typically less, I'd say, but in some places, yes. But, well, certainly, for instance, in the prelude, when the thing comes back and you have, you know, all this stuff, this, you know, this people going. And other ones going. In a different time signature, all against, you know, the. So you have all that stuff certainly going on. But the melody itself is played by a large group of instruments, not the same, coming and going. And that's more what I was really referring to, is the complex orchestration already exists. The complex orchestration in Wagner kind of starts with Tristan. The most complex orchestration I can think of in all of Wagner might be Brangaena's Watch, with all the solo string lines and everything. I mean, there's just an unbelievable amount going on there. And there is music in the ring that kind of foretells the kind of mixed colors that you hear in Parsifal. The Norn scene would be but even so, there's still far higher reliance on solo lines, on solo parts. This is just the Parsifal, he really gets away from that. Yes, back there.
I'd just like to make a comment first and then ask you my question. Mm-hmm. What is so amazing about what you say and the way Wagner composed the actual music he himself did the music, he himself did the orchestrations, which is very rare for an opera composer.
My
question was going to be, what other opera composers compose their own orchestrations?
Until the 20th century. I mean, only in the 20th century with operetta, Broadway musicals, things like that. Otherwise, all Verdi.
Verdi didn't do his own.
Oh, sure he did. Absolutely. Worked very hard on it. I mean, it's a very much more formulaic kind of orchestration, but Verdi orchestrated his own scores. Donizetti, Bellini, Puccini. Puccini's a great orchestrator. Mozart, Beethoven, Weber, they all orchestrated their own scores. It's only in the 20th century that you start getting... Okay. Now, they didn't write their own stories. They didn't do their own dramaturgies. They didn't have their own librettos. They didn't help design the stagings. Wagner did all those things, and none of them did. But as far as the orchestration, they all did. But there is a difference, which is that in all the cases that I mentioned, including really Puccini, who's always thought of as a great orchestrator, I think that the composers most of the time thought of the orchestra in a very symbolic way. And orchestration was done rather formulaically. You know, they had certain solo lines involved. And of course, Verdi has these famous, like, big violin solo in Due Foscari and great, huge clarinet solo in Lombardi and, you know, and other, you know, big solo things. But and the oboe line, fourth act of Otello. But I don't think that they lavished anything like as much creativity, attention to the orchestra and the orchestration that, as Wagner did. There's one reason for that, of course, is that Wagner was a conductor. Wagner could arguably be the first professional conductor that there ever was in the modern sense of the term. I mean, obviously, other people conduct early ones like, you know, Mozart may have led his operas too, but conducting then consisted of sitting at the forte piano and sort of, you know, giving the downbeat kind of thing. The conductor as interpreter, conductor as really leader of the orchestra, in the sense that we mean it, really starts with Wagner to a large extent.
And the next thing I'd like to ask is, how does the conductor and the players in the pit, how can they manage playing different time signatures at the same time?
Yeah, well, that's a good question. The way they do is they have... Okay, well, I have to answer the question. Let me answer it separately, how the players do it and how the conductor does it. It's a bigger problem for the conductor than for the players, because the conductor has to keep track. You know, when I was at Juilliard, I was a composition student as well as a piano student, and I took advanced ear training, which was mostly just for composers and conductors, all the people in the class. And one of the things we had to learn to do was to play in 3/4 and sing in 5 simultaneously, and then change 3/5 and 4. And the idea was to learn as a conductor to be able to conduct simultaneously in 3/4 and 5. It's as hard as it sounds, if not harder. It's hard. But you can do it. You just have to learn how to do it. So the conductor has to learn how to, you know, if in this case, if it's one, so the main tune is in 4, but the wind parts are playing. In 3. You have to be able to hear the 3. The 3 is very slow, so it makes it hard to hear. Well, they just play their parts. If the conductor gives the beat for them, what the conductor does, what they have, they've heard it before, presumably a nice sight reading. One thing is that you've obviously noticed is that musicians don't look at the conductor very much. They look at the conductor when they need to. Don't forget, too, they look a lot more in rehearsal than they do in performance, of course. So what the conductor has to do in cases like that is to establish, you know, to the musicians, okay, your beat is 1, 2, 3, 4. Your beat is 1, ba, ba, 1, two, three, one, two, three, one, two, three, four, one. So I'm doing it now. Okay. And you just establish that the musicians that they know which one to play. And the ones they have in their head, they just play. They don't pay any attention to it. But they can't listen. What you can't do is listen. If you listen, you're screwed. You just play. If you listen, you're going to catch up on the other guy's beat. You know. Now, Wagner has already done this before in Tristan a little bit. Sure, but mostly I think you have to go to the 20th century. 20th century, that happens quite a lot. Excuse me? Falstaff may very well. I don't know Falstaff well enough to say, but it could easily do so. Uh-huh. Yeah. What am I talking about? There's a famous one far earlier than that. What about the finale of Act One of Don Giovanni, where you have three bands on stage playing in three completely different time signatures simultaneously? You have one playing in 2-4-1, then 3-4-1, and 3-8, and they all fit right together. So it goes back a long ways. That's really hard because they don't have the guys on the stage musicians, theoretically not following anybody. I mean, they can't see the conductor very well. They probably in some cases have somebody off stage conducting them, but it's hard. That's why we rehearse. Mm-hmm. Yeah, usually those are just cues, though. Those are cues to telling them telling them not what rhythm to sing in, but where to come in.
Right, exactly.
I guess the one in Don Giovanni is the first one I can think of. I mean, it's limited, and there are three dances, and once you have it in your head, you can do it, but it's tricky. It's indisputably tricky. Anybody else? Mm-hmm.
Music carries the happenings, the dramaturgy, mm-hmm. and everything. So Kundry has various appearances, yet her voice is...
Yes.
I mean, it's not changing from mezzo to dramatic soprano or something.
Okay. A good Kundry should certainly sound very... She doesn't have this problem in Act 3 because she doesn't sing anything. All she says is, Dienen, and that's... Then she... She groans some and says Dina, Dina, but the Kundry of Act One should sound very different from the Kundry of Act Two, even though it is the same voice, because they're very different kinds of people. But, you know, I mean, what about Wotan in the Ring? I mean, of course, that's true. It's in different operas, but different works, but surely the Wotan of the Wanderer should sound rather different from the Wotan of Rheingold, this young, sort of on the make and ambitious guy, is no longer the one who's on, you know, on the stage in Siegfried. I think that's just part of being a great... The role of Kundry is interesting. It's not a very... Notwithstanding the huge leap we have in the famous Und Lachte, that's where she has to go. When she says she laughs to Christ on the cross, it goes... She sings. Try that sometime. Und Lachte. Not easy. That notwithstanding, she has to do a lot of screaming at the end. I don't think it's a terribly difficult role, vocally per se. And not even though she sings more than Parsifal does, it's not a terribly long role either. It's only really one long role in Parsifal, and that's Gornemanz. And he has all of Act Two to rest, so he does have at least a nice long rest in the middle. I assume they take a nap or something. excuse me. But Kundry does have to undergo, even within Act Two, she undergoes a lot of changes. I mean, she goes from being initially this mystery woman, talking about his mother, and, you know, talking about, I saw the babe on his mother's breast. And it should sound not so much like innocence, but like something from the deep past. And then she becomes more and more seductive. And then, of course, she becomes very complex. The Kundry of the end of Act Two is extraordinarily complex because she goes from moments of exaltation to moments of despair, moments of really high-level emotional blackmail. After all, the whole story of Christ on the cross is a form of terrible blackmail. She's trying to get him into bed any way she can, and, you know, saying, you know, I laughed at Christ on the cross, and only you can save me by having sex with me. It's pretty. Once she's figured out that this guy is being motivated by compassion now, you know, that he won't have sex with her because he's feeling sorry for her. I'm 40. He says, what about me? If you want to feel sorry for somebody, what about me? So she has to undergo a lot, and then she's the angry woman, spurned at the end, when she's calling Klingsor to come get rid of him. And so she has to go through. I would imagine that it's kind of a fun role to sing, actually. I think that there's one very major reason why many mezzos or soprano. I don't think Wagner calls for it mezzo. I think he calls her a soprano in the score, but it's almost usually sung by mezzo. Why mezzos don't like singing it, or sopranos don't like singing it. There's one thing about Kundry that's very unattractive to an opera singer. Oh, I think they love to scream. And moan, they get to moan and scream, come on. Who doesn't like to moan and scream? And the only time that's not good is when it's your next door neighbor. Then it's just embarrassing. But no, okay. What? There's something about Kundry's role which is highly unattractive to an opera singer. Well, yeah, that's highly unattractive to some opera singers, but yeah, nowadays they all have to act. But something else. She doesn't sing in the last act. She's on stage the whole last act, she says two words. I think that's really tough. I think that must be highly unattractive you've been around actors all your life. I mean, what actor likes that? It's gotta be awful. So that's, look at Isolde or Brunhilde. I mean, not only do they sing at they sing the end. They're the star of the show. The curtain comes down, and the first, the biggest ovation is always for them, unless they've totally been a fiasco, because they've had the great moment. Poor Kundry doesn't get anything like that. So I think that's unattractive.